Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Paul begins after establishing the liberty we find in Christ and establishing who we are in Christ and some other things. He then turns to a heart issue with him, and that is the state of Israel. Romans chapter 9, Romans 6, 7, 8 talks about righteousness being imparted, then we move into righteousness rejected. And this chapter 9 has been used often to purport teachings along the lines of election that just aren't accurate. And taken outside their context of what Paul was talking about here. I will be doing a lot of reading tonight from the complete biblical library when we get down to those verses that become somewhat cumbersome. Somebody will take a scripture and go, hey, see, it says right here, and they'll take it out of context. They won't set it in any kind of setting, and then they'll go teach some stuff that just isn't, how do we say, accurate. So Paul says here, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. Why? Now, Paul had just got through establishing sin, all under sin, that Gentile was under sin, the Jew was under sin, all were under sin, but then that the free gift of God was righteousness through Jesus Christ, all those different things that they received, righteousness had been imputed, righteousness was imparted, they were living a sanctified, saved life, they were living in a whole new plane altogether, and he comes to this, to the thing that's burdening him, Israel has rejected this. The Gentiles have received it, Israel has rejected it. He says, I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart, for I could wish that myself were accursed, anathema here is a curse, for Christ, for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth to the adoption, and the glory, and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and of the promises. Who are the fathers, and of whom, whose are the fathers, and of whom are, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God blessed forever. And I got my light on. All right, there we go. Not as though the word had taken none effect, for they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Now, Paul begins here to establish the spiritual Israel versus the carnal or the fleshly Israel. The natural descendants of Abraham versus the spiritual descendants of Abraham. Those who are Abraham after the flesh and those who are Abraham after the faith of Abraham of the Spirit. Those who are circumcised of the heart and not of the flesh. Okay. They are neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be. Now, Isaac not referring to the natural lineage. Remember that Isaac was the promise. Isaac was the promise. It wasn't Ishmael. It had to be Isaac. It couldn't be the seed of the flesh. It had to be the seed of the Spirit, the seed of promise. That is, that which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come. And Sarah, and somebody go get me some water, please. We ended up without any. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. And not this only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of him that called. Now, if you start looking, you obviously go, oh, see, he's talking about election. But if you go back and study the rest of Paul's writings, you find out Paul makes reference to election on the basis of foreknowledge. For whom he did foreknow, he did predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. So Paul's position on election is according to foreknowledge, whom God foreknew. So you have to interpret what Paul says about election in the light of God's foreknowledge, who would accept, who would reject. Just can't take it out of that setting. If you do, you come up with some really, as we'll read here later, fatalist approach to sovereignty. God doesn't, and there's things God doesn't do. God doesn't just change his character and go off on the deep end. Okay? It was said unto her, the elder shall also serve the younger. Now, I'm going to go ahead and read down through about, let me see here. Let's read down about verse 24, and I won't read the whole chapter right now, and I'll come back. I'm going to start getting into some stuff. And I'm going to stop editorializing until I get back to over here. What shall we say then? I'm sorry. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. I'm going to have to editorialize. The word hated here is the word hate, but when used in conjunction with the word love this way, it means to hold in relative disregard. Okay? So, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I loved less, is actually how it could be translated. Okay? It's not, he hates with disdain and absolute disregard. Thank you, Cap. All right. When used this way in the Greek, it means it's put in the contrast. I love this one. I did, and I held this one in a relative disregard as opposed to this one. I loved him less. Okay, didn't hate him. Okay, because she's looking at it. God loved. See, God hates. Well, that's where you run into sometimes with the King James and its word for word translation, and we don't go do a little study and go a little bit deeper. And do some study with Greek commentary and so forth, and find out the structure of what it means. It carries a little bit different slant or meaning when you understand that. Not everybody is a Greek scholar, but we can read behind those who are. Okay, and that's what they've done. They've studied and they put it out there for us to look at. Let's look at it, not be so shallow. And you know, and that's why we need to be studied to show ourselves approved. A workman who needeth not be ashamed. Ministers particularly. You guys need to be, you know, go do some study and not just take your church doctrine or what somebody's taught you about election and run off with it and just because it says something, you know, and you didn't do any study to find out a little bit deeper. What shall we say then? Remember, Paul does this all the time. You know, shall we continue to sin that grace may abound? You know, Paul's always doing rhetorical questions and then he answers his own questions. He says here, what shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid. For he said to Moses, I will have mercy, and we're going to get into this. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. See then, it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, for the same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that by my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will, he hardeneth. Now, a little quick thing here. Pharaoh hardened his own heart 9 times before God hardened it. Okay? So it wasn't that God made him and then hardened his heart. Pharaoh hardened his own heart. And after enough of that, God said, okay. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this purpose that I've raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that through that that by my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore he will have mercy on whom he will have mercy, whom he will, he hardeneth. That wilt say unto me, thou wilt say then unto me, why doth then thou find fault? For who hath resisted his will? Nay, but, O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed, why hast thou made me thus? Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel in honor and another unto dishonor? And what if God, willing to show wrath, make his power known, endure with much long suffering the vessels of wrath? Now, notice he endured them. Okay? Fitted to destruction. That he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had afore prepared for glory. Even us whom he called, not only of the Jews, but also of the Gentiles. Now, let's get in here. We're going to pick up the complete biblical library. We're going to get over here. You know, I kind of explained where Paul's coming from when he starts this. His heart is heavy because of Israel, because they've rejected God. Okay? And so we'll pick up. Let's look at verse 6. We'll talk about verses 6 and 7. Complete biblical library out of print. You can get it in electronic form. I forgot who sells it, but you can look up the complete biblical library. There is an electronic form of this that works with Logos. It has like 60 volumes of books and stuff on computer form. I love it. It's just awesome. I just click and all the stuff that I had to pull out books and lay out and put and flip, 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 flip. It's all right there that I can cut and paste. Hey, da ba ba ba. Hallelujah. All right, verse 6. Not as though the word of God hath done effect. For they are not all Israel, which are Israel, neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they the children of God, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. All right. Complete biblical library. God hath given honor to Israel. His son was born in a human family by a Jewish mother. He was raised in a Jewish home, attended a Jewish synagogue, and received a Jewish education. Paul never denied that the Jews were God's chosen people. Not all Jews rejected Christ. Nearly all of his early followers were Jews. God always had a righteous remnant who were true to him. Remember that when Elijah said, I'm the only one left. He said, I reserve 7,000 who've not bowed their knee to Baal. He went through that all the time. All right? The apostle, in summary, stated that Israel is a chosen people, but to be a member of Israel means more than racial descent. God has not failed to keep his promise. It was limited to the remnant. Physical descent from Abraham does not make one a child of God. Reference John 8, 37 through 44. Remember that you are your father, the devil. Galatians 3, 7. Ishmael was the seed of the flesh. Isaac was a child of promise. Mere birth into the nation did not make a person a real Israelite. God accepted Israelites who were those of spiritual character. The Israel distinguished from the Israel of natural descent is the true Israel. Jesus made a parallel distinction when he spoke of Nathanael as an Israelite indeed in John 1:47. Paul referred to the true Israel as Israel according to the Spirit, Galatians 4:29 in the New American Standard Version. The same distinction was stated earlier and related to the term Jew and to the circumcision in Romans 2:29. Both believing Jews and believing Gentiles are included in the Israel of God. Remember, there's the three races of men, the Jew, the Gentile, and the Israel of God. Amen? Verse 8, that which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this, the word of promise, at this time will I come, and Sarah will have a son. And not only this, but Rebekah also conceived by one, even by our father Isaac. The children of promise were those who, like Abraham, believed the promise of God, and as a result were Abraham's spiritual offspring. Paul made it very plain that the Jews could not base their claims to election. This is where he begins to argue against, he starts talking about election, and if you don't understand what he's trying to do, you get confused. You know, everybody's elect because, you know, if you're saved, you're elect. Yes, but according to foreknowledge. And we'll read some things here that are interesting. Paul made it very plain that the Jew could not base their claims to election based on their fleshly relationship to Abraham. The fleshly children were not necessarily the children of God. This was contrary to the general viewpoint. Israel, according to the flesh, was the avenue by which God chose to bring the Messiah, and as such, Israel enjoyed certain privileges. God's promise to Abraham or his seed that he should be the heir of the world was not by the law, but through righteousness by faith. The promise was still, that's Romans 4:13. The promise still continues even to this day. Abraham is the father in a spiritual sense of all those who believe. Amen. Where was I? Just lost my place. I looked up to make eye contact and lost it. Mm-hmm. Of all those who believe, Jew or Gentile, who walk in the steps of that faith, Paul exploited the idea that being a physical descendant of Abraham exploited the idea that being a physical descendant of Abraham automatically made one a child of God. The emphasis here is on the premium God places on our standing on his promises. The word of promise, found in verse 9, is the same as the word of God in verse 6. Children of God are the children of promise. God promised Abraham a son. He promised by performing a miracle. The son of promise was Isaac. In God's sovereign plan, Sarah, son, not Hagar or Kethros, was the one selected. Now, God chose who he was going to select, but there was still the process of faith, and it wasn't overriding the will of man. It had to be done, but they had to get in faith. The Jews understood that the selection process among their forebears, Ishmael was the son of Abraham, born into the patriarchal family, but no Jew would acknowledge Ishmael's descendants, the Arabs, as being the chosen people. Esau was much of a son of Isaac as with Jacob. Yet no Jew would countenance Esau as their leader. Abraham pleaded with God on the behalf of Ishmael. And Isaac tried to give the patriarchal blessing to Esau. But the promise came through Isaac. By that line of argument, Paul presented the fact that the seed was not of human lineage, but through the righteousness of faith. Then verse 11. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to the election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. Two expressions, and this begins, this is very important, because this leads into the next few verses where it talks about the lump and the clay and all that. Two expressions need explanation. First, the purpose of God was to have a family who, through the righteousness provided by his son, would be like his son. The second term needing explanation is election. Election is not based on the flesh, nor on works. The basis is him that calleth. The Jew cannot say, I am elected because I descended from Abraham. The self-righteous cannot say, we are elected because of our good works. The legalist cannot say, I am chosen because I obeyed the law. Election is not based on works, but on the call of God. Now remember, Paul wrote and said, for whom he did foreknow, no, he did predestine to be conformed to the image of his son. Okay? All right? Actually, I need to find that verse. Can we find that? Is Blinda's not in there? Oh, no, that's all right. I mean, you don't have to run back and forth. I'll find it. Hallelujah. All right. There we go. Search. Or new. No, we have to have the F in there. There we go. Search. I may not be on the internet. All right. I can't find it. For whom he foreknew, he did predestine to be conformed to the image of his son. And that, there's a passage that's talking about when he called, he did this. Okay, I'll go on and read while they look for that. Election is not based on works, but on the call of God. Those who answer the call are elected. The Jew, the self-righteous, the legalist could all argue their case, but to no avail. God will save whom he will. And whom he will is those who chose to accept Jesus. Huh? Guess I should have really, we were just there last week. No. Romans 8:25? Yeah, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, he also called. Whom he called, he also justified. Whom he justified, them he also glorified. Now, so the writer here is saying this. He said, election is not based on works, but on the call of God. Who got called? Those whom he foreknew. And those he foreknew, he did predestinate. And whom he predestinated, he called. So your election is based on the foreknowledge of God that you would accept the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. Okay? It's not based on anything else. All right? Who is the saved one? The answer is, whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have everlasting life. John 3:16. This is where we get into trouble in the Bible. When you take an isolated scripture or a passage that fits a mantra that you want to have, and you build a doctrine on it without including all the other stuff or leaving all the other things out. You just can't leave it all out. You can't leave out that God's not willing that any should perish, that all should come to the knowledge of the truth. Paul clearly establishes, remember how we do in the military, we got the Bush doctrine, the Obama doctrine, the Reagan doctrine, the Monroe doctrine. Those are systems of governance that they established based on their belief system. Okay? Well, the Paul doctrine of election is established on the foundation and the presumption of foreknowledge. So that when Paul writes in reference to election, it has to be understood within the parameters and the light of foreknowledge of who would. Those he did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, whom he did predestinate, he called. Okay? He wasn't willing that any would perish, but the ones who accepted got called. Okay? They received the election because he saw them accept his will. All right. God has made made possible a way, a predestinated way. What's the predestinated way? He's predestined to be conformed to the image of his son and be called if you accepted Jesus. He saw that. Like one guy said, God sits in the middle of a spoke wheel. And this is, in every spoke is a place in time. He can go back, he can go forward, he can go to right now. He can see all the places of time just by looking at different areas. He looked ahead and saw you get saved. And when he saw you get saved, he predestined you to be conformed to the image of his son. And he called you. Okay? So you're elect by his calling, but his calling is based on the fact he knew you would accept Jesus. This is where free will and election come together. Amen. Your free will, he knew, would be to accept Jesus. Or he knew to reject him. And based on that, his election was enforced. If you just read this little bit out of Romans and go get some other teaching from people who just believe in pure sovereign election and there's nothing you can do about it, you'll come out squirreled. Your head will be spinning. And the reason it spins is because none of the other Bible makes sense. There's all the other scriptures don't make any sense. You can't reconcile them. Okay? God made possible a way, a predestined way, whereby all Jew and Gentile who believe are elected. The unrighteous Gentiles, the self-righteous Jews, can be saved only through faith. If God made you do it, it's not faith. If God forced you to do it, then it's not faith. It's not an act of belief. It's not an adherence and a trust in Him based on what He said. It is you were forced to do it. That's not faith. Okay? 12 and 13. Not all the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were within the design of God to carry out His plan. There were more than physical. There was more than physical descent. There was specific selection. Paul noted that there was an electing within the family of Abraham's physical descendants, a point the Jews understood and accepted. A further point is that the election was not on the basis of deed or merit. Jacob was chosen and Esau was rejected before they were born. It wasn't because Esau was a jerk and Jacob was great. God had already decided it. The only preference would normally be priority of birth, and God disregarded that. No legal works, no Jewish birth, could give a person a claim that God must honor. His acts were according to a sovereign will. So here he is. Paul explains. See, is this making any sense to help anybody in Romans 9? Because I was reading some other stuff recently, and I was reading, and I'm going, guys, you got my head spinning with your goobity-gawk. Because, you know, they were just talking stuff, and, you know, Paul didn't even understand the question. That's what one of them said. You know, Paul didn't understand what he was talking about here. He never even answered his own question. Like, oh, brother. Paul was confused. He wasn't confused. So, a further point is that the election was not on the basis of deed or merit. Jacob was chosen, and Esau was rejected before they were born. The only preference would normally be priority of birth. That means first one born gets the birthright. And God disregarded that. In other words, the Jews don't get it just because they were natural descendants. No legal works, you know, not the law. No Jewish birth could give a person a claim that God must honor. His acts were according to his sovereign will. And his sovereign will was you come by faith. Esau never served Jacob in the natural, they're individualized. Therefore, we know God was speaking of something besides individual election. God was speaking of a time when Esau's descendants, the Edomites, would serve Israel, Malachi 1 and 4. 1 and 4. Therefore, the election here is corporate. Jacob was chosen to be in the line of Christ. All election pertaining to salvation is corporate in the elect one, Christ Jesus. So it wasn't, you know, Esau or Jacob was some special elect one. It was his descendants, his race, his lineage. All right. Love and hated are contrasted. It is not literal hatred, but the same kind Jesus requires in John 14:26. A form of the Greek term misio, which is hate, is used here in verse 13, emesia. It does not mean detest or to reject. It means to place a much lower priority in one's concern. It was not possible for both Jacob and Esau to receive the birthright and be in the line of Messiah. Therefore, one must be chosen, elected, and the other not chosen, hated. Our love for Jesus must be so much greater than our love for father, mother, and all else. And by comparison, the lesser love could be called hate. You don't hate your parents, but and your family. You have to hold them in relative disregard or in a lower esteem than God. And I think we've missed that in the church. We hold so many things above God. And I won't jump on that tonight, or I may later. There will be times when we have to choose between him and loved ones. When choice is unavoidable, the not chosen, whether Esau or our treasures, may be described as hated. You have to obey God. You have to do what God says to do. We have a mantra in the church now. Quite frankly, I think our mantra on love is out of whack, is out of balance. Because people say things in the name of love that just aren't scriptural. People do things in the name of love that just aren't scriptural. We maintain certain positions because it's supposedly love that the Bible, it just violates the word. You know, can't call sin sin because that's not love. That's not the Bible. The Bible, love calls sin sin. We're big. You'll get over it. All right. The choice of Jacob rather than Esau had nothing to do with eternal salvation. Esau still had the opportunity to serve God and put his faith in him. The repentance he could not find was the recovery of the birthright he had forfeited, not his walk with God. He couldn't get his birthright back. Okay? He did not seek to repent of his... The repentance he could not find was the recovery of his birthright he had forfeited. He did not seek to repent of his profane lifestyle immorality. The only thing he tried to repent, the only thing he repented of and couldn't find it was giving away his birthright. And that just means he was sorry he did it. Okay? It's called buyer's remorse. You ever had elections where people come back later and say, man, I made a mistake? It's called buyer's remorse. You ever bought something and you go, man, I shouldn't have done that? You shouldn't have bought that, and you can't get rid of it. You're stuck with it. That's buyer's remorse. Esau had buyer's remorse. He repented. He wanted to get his birthright back, but he couldn't get it back. But he never did try to repent of his lifestyle. Amen? The destiny of Israel had been shaped by their experience with two persons, Moses and Jacob. The Jews were separated from other peoples to be God's witness to the nations, to be custodians of his law. The choice was not based upon numerical strength, power and wealth, or righteousness. Based on God just chose them. God just chose them to be his representatives. This passage lays the foundation for the truth of God's sovereignty over Israel. Israel, God's chosen nation, came into existence by the supernatural act of God. The bodies of Abraham and Sarah were as good as dead, but God performed a miracle to beget Abraham's seed. If God had not acted, there would have not been a nation. Verse 14, what shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid. For he has said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then, it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of him that showeth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for the same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. In the pattern found so often in Romans, Paul opened this portion with a question. Paul does this all the time. I love it. Is there unrighteousness with God? The answer is a resounding, God forbid. Paul presented a discussion that contains one of the most profound mysteries of our world. Israel must leave God to his sovereignty. Like Jacob, Moses received the mercy of God by obeying became the deliverer of Israel. Like Esau, Pharaoh rejected God's mercy and was hardened. Moses was the vessel of mercy. Pharaoh was the vessel of wrath. God does not create human beings for the purpose of condemning them. If you read this outside of understanding anything, that's the conclusion you can come to. Okay? Nor is he responsible for the sinfulness of men. In Pharaoh's case, God gave him chance after chance to repent. Pharaoh's heart was not hardened until after he had rejected the light which came from God. The scripture recounts 10 times when it is said that Pharaoh hardened himself. Pharaoh did not want God. He hardened his heart first of his own volition. Then God made an example of his displeasure with sin and of those who would spurn his love and grace. Okay? So, you read this and somebody teaches on pure election. God made Pharaoh harden his heart. No, Pharaoh hardened his own heart. And you remember over in Romans back in the beginning where it talked about those who did not retain God in their knowledge, and that men work with men, that would turn from the natural use of the woman, burn the lust one to another. Women also leaving the natural use of the man, burn the lust one to another, and God gave them over to a reprobate mind. Why? He didn't do that first. It did not say he gave them over to a reprobate mind, and then they went and did that. It said they rejected him, burned in their lust one way or another, and against him, and then he turned them over to a reprobate mind. God did not make them reprobate, and then they went out and did it. They had become, they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. They worshiped the creature more than the creator. They rebelled against God, and they kept doing it, and kept doing it, and kept doing it, and he just finally turned them over to a reprobate mind to work that which was unseemly. He did not make them a homosexual. You're not born a homosexual. You yield to that either because you got connected with somebody who's already got that spirit on them, or you've rejected the counsel of God. Amen. And you keep walking that way and keep walking that way and keep walking that way. And if you keep rejecting his love and his mercy, he will turn you over to a reprobate mind. It means one void of judgment. You can't judge. You can't make the right decisions. God didn't make you that way. This study sits at, go take that study and blow it up with some dynamite. You can prove anything you want to prove anytime you want to prove it with the right amount of grant money. The big study that everybody used to say that the population of the United States was homosexual was 10% came from a study in 1948 in prisons. In prisons, where they know that the homosexual population is higher than the general populace. That went over big. But nobody talks about that. There was a study done. Yeah, what? It was a skewed study. You're not born reprobate. You're not born without the love and mercy. God did not make you a sinner. God didn't make you that way. I remember my kids were in school. One of the girls said that when she was in class, one bozo said, you know, that he believed that God made prostitutes so he could save them. Anyway. You need to do a better study of your Bible. Pharaoh hardened himself. Pharaoh did not want God. He hardened his heart of his own volition. Then God made an example of him. An example of his displeasure with sin and of those who reject or spurn his love and grace. He says, my spirit will not always strive with man. You can't keep rejecting the dealings of God. There is a limitation. Some people don't believe this. There is a limitation to where he will let his love and mercy go. And when it reaches the point that he knows you're going to reject it, then behold the goodness and the severity of God. We know I talked about this in Word of Faith churches. Especially now in the new slippery Gracie churches. But the fact of the matter is, there is the goodness of God and there is the severity of God. The goodness of, let me say this, the goodness of God always comes first. And it is extended with long suffering and long patience. If you keep rejecting it and keep rejecting it and keep rejecting it and keep rejecting it, eventually you're going to run out of the goodness into the severity. God doesn't do that. Where do you think that's in the Bible from? All right. God gave Pharaoh, as well as Moses, an outstanding revelation of his power and his mercy. Listen, Pharaoh was watching all the miracles just like Moses was. Pharaoh could have repented and had the whole nation worship the God of Moses. Hello? Egypt had been spared 400 years before because God gave one of his people a revelation and Pharaoh elevated him to second in command under him. And Israel was preserved because of it. Pharaoh saw all the miraculous things. If you go back and study the plagues, each one of the plagues addressed a belief or a god of Egypt. And God showed that he was God. And Pharaoh kept hardening his heart against the God of heaven. Hallelujah. God gave Pharaoh as well as Moses an outstanding revelation of his power and his mercy. Moses was responsive. Pharaoh was rebellious. The revelation melted and shaped Moses while it hardened Pharaoh. Now, how many times have I said we can sit right here in this church and preach a scripture and somebody sit there going, "Woo, I got a revelation." And the next person is packing up and leaving the church because they're ticked off with me. Same scripture, same teaching. One's getting blessed, one's getting ticked. One's Moses, one's Pharaoh. Now, you don't want to follow those examples to the end if you're on the Pharaoh side. Because you keep hardening and keep rebelling, and you know, then you're going to run into trouble. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. The gospel does the same thing wherever it is preached. Some will yield. Others will reject. God has elected that whosoever believeth on his son shall have eternal life. God has elected that whosoever believeth on his son shall have eternal life. Election is based on whosoever believeth on the foreknowledge of God. If the Jew objects that God ignores his rights by lineage, by law, and by nationality, God reminds him that he has elected that all who believe shall be saved. The message which preached. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And there were people who rejected that message. Recognition of the will of God for salvation of all men completely negates any determinate system of theology. God will have all people to be saved, 1 Timothy 2:4. He is the Savior of all men, especially those who believe. 1 Timothy 4:10. Potentially, he is the Savior of every person born. Only those who believe and receive are actually saved. But his mercy extends to all. God's sovereignty never excludes his mercy. The fact that any person enjoys God's blessing is of his mercy freely given. Let's read 18 and 19, and then we'll go on and quit there. Thou wilt say unto me, why doth he yet find fault? For who has resisted his will? Nay, but, O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall a thing formed say to the thing that formed it, why hast thou made me such? In verse 21, hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? That's interesting when we get there. We may not get there tonight because it's my life. Verse 18, this is one of the strongest statements in the New Testament about the sovereignty of God's will. This must be balanced. And we said, therefore, he hath mercy on whom he hath mercy, and he will harden whom he hardeneth. This is one of the strongest statements in the New Testament about the sovereignty of God's will. This must be balanced with the many invitations in the New Testament to believe and accept Christ. God does not entice nor calls men to do evil. James 1:13 and 14. God tempteth no man with evil, but every man is tempted. Amen? You know, God doesn't make you sin. But, you know, the extreme electionists believe that, teach that, you know. God makes you do things. The extreme electionists, you don't even know if you are saved. Don't even know if you can get saved. You know? Well, that's right. There's a problem with that. James 1, I'm still getting these pages separated, folks, this new Bible that y'all gave me. So, thank you, but. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted of evil, neither tempted he any man. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Anybody says that God makes you sin, lied. Anyway, there it is. They're lying or they're bozos, or they're a bozo liar. Sorry. When people do wrong, it comes from their depraved nature. The rabbis of Paul's day looked upon God's covenant with Israel. Listen to this. And this is why he makes his argument this way. As such, that no matter how sinful Israel was, their place in God could never change. They held to the premise of absolute predestination, that the Gentiles were to be destroyed, but nothing could dissolve God's covenant with the Jew. Paul meets the objection offered by sincere Jewish believers. They could not understand how Israel, to whom belonged the honors listed in chapter 9, verses 4 and 5, could be set aside for the Gentiles who were brought from their alienated and lost status to the place of blessing. The apostle proves that the word of God cannot fail. He makes a distinction between the natural offspring and the spiritual offspring. God accepted the Israelites are now those of spiritual character. Perhaps the following illustrates God's election. The door to the temple of salvation says, whoever will may come, but inside is inscribed the message, chosen in him before the foundation of the world. Whoever will come, but those who came and did come, chosen from the foundation of the world. God has always had total omniscience. That means omniscience is a big word, all-knowing. Omniscience, omniscience. Okay, so it's the combination of omni, all, and science. And it makes pronounced omniscience, okay? All-knowing. God has always had total omniscience, foreknowing all things, potential and actual. Because he is God, he can have total prescience. That can't be pronounced that way. Prescience. Prescience? That word, prescience. All right. Look, forget it. My brain just didn't get wrapping around it. I'll get it one day. He can have total prescience. Prescience. Hallelujah! I told you I'd get it. Hallelujah! And yet allow men to make genuine choices of their own wills. See what happened? It's kind of like the prime directive of Star Trek. Okay? In Star Trek, the prime directive is they can't interfere. Even if they went back in time or went forward in time, they can't interfere. They may know something's going to happen, but they can't interfere. God knows what you're going to do, but he doesn't interfere and make you do something one way or the other. Once you do, is that all right? So this is the prime directive of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He can have total prescience and yet allow men to make their own genuine choices on their own wills. Man's will is not free in the absolute sense as God is, but man is totally free in the decision as to do who will be his master, either God or Satan. The choice determines his eternal destiny. So what we say is this, we've always said this, man is a subordinate being. He has a free will, but his free will means he will operate either under God or under Satan. He cannot operate independent of one of those two realms. He has to operate within one of those two realms. So even though he's a free agent and can choose, he still has to choose you this day, life or death, blessing or cursing. You have to operate one of the realms. You can't operate independent of either realm. You can't go out there and be your own God, hang out, like the Mormons teach. You can't go out there and hang out and do your own thing outside the realm of Satan or God. It is congruous, yeah, for the creature to judge the creator. Men are not lost because God has hardened them. They are hardened because they are lost. They are lost because they are sinners. God is not responsible for man's sin, but he offers mercy to all. We better stop here. I've got to stop here. Next week, I'm going to have to read some more out of this. Y'all enjoying that? I told Brother Bill, I said, it's best commentary on Romans 9 I've ever seen. Because it gets it. See, you have to establish the proper premise in order to understand things. And when you understand the proper premise of foreknowledge is the basis of predestination and election, then that changes everything. Okay? Have you ever heard it teach, taught that God hardened Pharaoh's heart? He's the lump, he's the clay, and he made him do all the things he did. And you go read the Bible, and the Bible says Pharaoh hardened himself 10 times. And God got fed up with it. I've shown you 10 things and I'm God. And you don't like it? Boom. All right? Have your way. Remember, this operated in other areas too. When Israel went to God, went to Samuel and said, we want a king. And Samuel went to God and was repenting for the nation because he said, don't you, you haven't rejected you, they rejected me. And then he had to go anoint Saul. And from that point on, the king was chosen, was supposed to be chosen by God. God chose the lineage and who was to be king. It was never his will. But they finally he was like, you want a king? You're going to have a king. And let me tell you how it's going to be. And it was exactly that way. You got a king, you rejected having me serve over you, now you're going to be doing this, and you're going to have this king, it's going to be good, this one's going to be bad, this is going to happen, that's going to be out, you're going to be in captivity, you're going to be out. It's going to be an up and down roller coaster, because you had to have that king. It wasn't God's will that they had the king, but once they did it, he let them have it. Be careful what you press God for. I've seen people press God for things that's not his will. And finally, he'll just let them do it. I said, he'll just let them do it. And they'll just be blind to the fact they're out of the will of God. They're out doing their thing, thinking they're blessed, thinking they're walking with God. And oh, the things they missed, the places in God they missed because they went away that wasn't what God wanted. But they pressed him and pressed him and pressed him, and he just finally said, okay. I don't believe he does that. Fine. Believe what you want to believe. Israel wanted a king and pressed about it. They got one. I got Bible. Hello. Y'all hear you going home.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.